Well, this time, children preschool through kindergarten are dismissed for children's church. And as they're going, I'm reminded of one announcement I failed to make earlier, and that is you received an email earlier in the week regarding the resumption of our church nursery. And Aaron Harrison is looking to for volunteers to staff the nursery. Just as a blessing to our young families who have children. And so if you haven't responded yet to Aaron, I'd encourage you to do so either in person or via text or email. And she will put a schedule together, and we will be up and running on that regard as well in the coming weeks. Blessings. That has been our subject over the last three Sundays, or last two Sundays, and including today. And recall that at the outset we identified God's blessing as those acts of God that bring Him glory by accomplishing His will and helping people to grow and to do His will. God's blessing is the way in which He becomes actively involved in the lives of His children, especially as we notice and experience it in times of difficulty. God's hand at work in our lives in response to our needs is one of the ways that He expresses His blessing to us. The first week that we looked at, we were talking about experiencing God's blessing. As we look out into 2021, how is it that we can position ourselves to, in fact, experience the blessing of God on our lives? We saw four ways as we looked at various Old Testament passages. As we allow Christ to reign and rule in our lives, as we feed on the Word of God, as we cling to Him in all circumstances of life, and as we do what Jesus did, as we emulate His character and His actions, as we do what Jesus did, we position ourselves in such a way as to experience the blessing of God. So we looked at experiencing God's blessing. Then last week, we looked at extending God's blessing. We looked at inviting others to come to know the living God through faith in Jesus Christ. We looked at the opportunity that is ours to introduce people to Christ and to pray that people will themselves become worshipers of Him. Well, finally, this morning we're looking at the subject of awaiting God's blessing. What do we do when we are anxiously waiting for God to show up and intervene in our lives when it seems like He's awfully slow in doing so? How do we respond? What do we do as we wait for His blessing? To that end, let's pray before we get into the Word this morning. Father, we thank You for the reminder that sometimes Your blessings, Your mercies are disguised from us. We don't normally see. Father, sometimes it's through tears that You bring Your blessing. Father, sometimes it's through anxious moments that we experience most closely the reality that You're with us. Father, we would ask that in these moments You would speak to us from Psalm chapter 4 and through the experience that David records for us of his own experience of waiting upon You. Father, we would ask that in these moments, as the psalmist writes, that the unfolding of Your Word gives light. And Father, as we unfold Your Word this morning, Father, may Your Holy Spirit shine the light of truth upon our hearts. Father, that we may be encouraged and that we may hear from You. Father, to this end we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. Well, having come through a recent presidential election, I thought back to 1996, when Senator Bob Dole was running for election against the incumbent President Bill Clinton. And if you are old enough, you recall that Senator Dole lost in a resounding way in that election. And someone asked him, and as he reflected upon the night of his loss, he told his friends, you know what, that night I slept like a baby. No, He said, I woke up every 3 hours and cried. Actually, when we hear the phrase, sleep like a baby, that's not the image that comes to mind, is it? Rather, we picture an infant cuddled and swaddled in a blanket, breathing rhythmically, a hint of a smile on their face, sleeping peacefully, absent any worries or concerns that would otherwise keep them awake. That's what we think of when we think of sleeping like a baby. And isn't that what we all want? To sleep like a baby, safe and secure from all alarm? I think that's what I want. I suspect that's what you'd want as well. Yet how many nights do we lie awake, fears gripping our hearts and growing ever larger in our minds, experiencing sleep that is more like Senator Dole's sleeping like a baby? Even as Christians, we, and I can speak personally for myself, even as a Christian, I all too often lie awake at night embroiled in fears and anxiety. And I hate when that happens because I know that I'm losing, first of all, valuable rest, and I'll pay for the price the next day. But more than that feeling, that as a child of God and followers of Jesus, and one who is indwelt by the Spirit of God, I keep thinking, I lay there at night thinking, I should be better than this. I should sleep in peace because I know I'm a child of God with nothing to fear. He is watching over me. How do I get there? Maybe you wrestle with that. How do you get there? The question we want to look at this morning is, how did David get there? In the book of Psalms, King David gives expression to a wide variety and array of emotions and experiences. In reading some of his psalms, you get the impression that his circumstances didn't allow him to sleep like a baby, but that he was often filled with fears and anxieties as he awaits, and sometimes as he waits impatiently for God to bless him by acting on his behalf. But other times, David exhibits a quiet confidence in God that seems to put his mind at ease even in the midst of the most trying of circumstances. One such place is Psalm chapter 4. The psalm ends with these words, I lie down and sleep in peace. For you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety. David probably had some sleepless nights. But as he was going through the circumstances we find in Psalm chapter 4, that was not his experience. He was lying down in peace because he knew that God was with him. David was sleeping like a baby in spite of the less than perfect realities of his life. As he wrote Psalm chapter 4, David was experiencing the peace of God, that sense of security and well-being that only God is able to give, even as he waited for God to intervene in his life's circumstances. So David's testimony is that which every child of God can experience. We, like David, experience the peace of God even as we await the blessing of God. We can experience the peace of God even as we wait for God to show up and intervene in our circumstances and in our lives. In Psalm chapter 4, David leads us to two realities which, if we keep them before us, they will or they can allow the peace of God to well up within us even as we wait on Him. So let's take a look at those this morning. Let's see what David did so that we can do what David did and find the peace and experience the blessing that David found in God. Though first of all, we notice this. We can experience peace as we wait for God's blessing, for His intervention, when we reflect upon the character of God. When we think about the character of God, when we lay awake at night and we try to recall who God is, that can allow a peace to flow over us. David begins, answer me when I call to you, O my righteous God. Give me relief from distress. Be merciful to me and hear my prayer. Though we don't know the specific situation that David found himself in, that could have robbed him of a peaceful night's sleep, he gives us some clues. He says, give me relief from distress. Distress here, it means a narrowing. At its root, it's a narrowing. To be distressed is to feel as though the walls are closing in on you. It means to feel constricted by events, so much so that you feel like you can't catch your breath. There's that narrowing, that suffocation. The events are just weighing upon you. Over the last couple days, maybe last week or so, we've been having some trouble with our dryer. I just hate when stuff like that happens. And so we called the guy, and he came and replaced a fuse, and it happened again, and called him again. He said, well, you may want to check your vent. Maybe it's clogged, and it's causing it to overheat. Well, in our house, that's not an easy fix. That means crawling into the crawl space under the whole width of the house to get to the vent where it comes from the floor, and then trying to wrestle in the dark between furnace pipes and runs and in the dark in a closed space, trying to hold a flashlight, hold a screwdriver, hold the part in the dark in a very confined and enclosed space. But Rhonda thought I needed to do it. So here I am, messing and wrestling with this yesterday afternoon. I was feeling the narrowing. Believe me, I was feeling the distress, the suffocation of that moment. And maybe you felt like that at times, where the space is just closing in on you, the circumstances are weighing upon you, and you can't hardly breathe. David cries out to God, give me relief from distress. We don't know exactly what he was experiencing, what was taking his breath away. We do have a hint in verse 2. It seems that the cause of his distress was against him as king and as of his right to reign. And it seems like there were some attacks on his personal character. David writes, how long, O men, will you turn my glory, my reputation, my character? They were making attacks upon the kind of guy, the kind of king, the kind of person he was. How long, O men, will you turn my glory, my reputation into shame? How long will you treat me so shamefully and so unfairly? How long will you love delusions? How long will you love lies about God and lies about me and seek false gods and not worship the one true living God? Note, too, that David's request of God was for relief. He was feeling distress, a narrowing. What he wanted was relief. Again, the root of this word means spaciousness and openness and wideness. David was feeling the air, the life squeezed out of him by his circumstances. He asked God for space that he might once again breathe deeply. Maybe there's something in your life that is presently giving you that similar sensation. Perhaps you feel like life is closing in on you. If so, then you can relate to David. And the good thing is that just like David, we too can find room to breathe and space to catch our breath and to experience the peace which David found even as he waited upon God to intervene on his behalf, even as he waited for God to bless him. And David found relief. He found room to breathe when he reflected on the character of God. He writes, answer me when I call to you, my righteous God. God's righteousness. David knows God is one who will always do what is right. And David is confident that God will do right by him in his present set of circumstances. The writer of Hebrews says, God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown Him as you have helped His people. God is not unjust. The writer of Hebrews knew God is the righteous God. He will always do right by His children. And David clung to that, reflected upon that, and be reminded of the kind of God He is. He found room to breathe. And likewise, David is confident that God will show up, and He will show up in His mercy. He writes, "Give me relief from my distress. Give me space from my narrowness. Be merciful to me and hear my prayer." Be merciful to me. God revealed Himself, His name, as you recall, and His character to Moses. In this way, with these words, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God. That word gracious, the same word here David uses, is translated as merciful. God is a gracious God. God told that to Moses. I am a gracious God. I am a merciful God. David, in all of his experiences with God, had come to know too that God is merciful. What's the blessing that we looked at 2 weeks ago? The Lord bless you and keep you and make His face to shine upon you. And what? Be gracious. Be merciful to you. That's the kind of God He is. And David knows that. And he knows that if God will simply be Himself. And we just got done singing. That is who You are. And David knew, this is who You are. You are the righteous and merciful God. And he clung to Him. And he laid his head down at night, reflecting upon the righteousness and the mercy of God. And he was able to dwell in safety and sleep in peace. Now, when we're awake at night, restless and anxious, oh, may our thoughts move to the righteousness of God and the mercy of God, knowing that if He just acts like who He is, if He is just Himself, and if He will just be true to Himself as He always is, then things will be well for God's child. On those occasions when we feel the breath being squeezed out of us by the onslaught of life, may we take time, as David did, to reflect upon the character of God. If you are a follower of Jesus Christ, you can be certain, if David was certain, that your Heavenly Father will do right by you, and He will be gracious to you. He will give you that which is needed to allow you to rest in peace and to experience His peace even as you wait for God to answer your prayer and to intervene in your circumstances. We find peace as we wait, as we reflect upon the righteousness and the mercy of God, just as David did. But David also tells us this: we can experience peace as we wait for God's blessing as we remember that we are set apart by God. We're set apart by Him. Begin verse 3, it appears that David begins to speak directly to his opponents, to the ones who were the cause of his grief. And he writes, "Know that the Lord has set apart the godly." He has set apart the godly. Now, he doesn't say it, but I think we can infer it, that David's talking about himself. He says, there are two types of people. There are the ungodly, like you. He doesn't say that. Those are causing me grief. Those who are casting aspersions upon God. There's that group. And there is the group that he sets apart and draws a distinction. Know that the Lord has set apart the godly for Himself. The Lord will hear when I, a godly person, call to Him. God doesn't hear all prayers equally. He has a special ear tuned to the voice of his child. Isn't that true as parents? You can hear a whole hubbub of kids, but if you hear your child cry out, "Mommy," you immediately know whose child that is, right? Because there is that special sensitivity to the voice of those nearest and dearest to you. And so David says, "Know that the Lord has set apart the godly for himself. The Lord will hear when I, his child, call to him. He will hear his voice. He will hear my voice," David says. David has every confidence that even though many people have rejected and despised him, he knew that God had chosen him and that God loved him. He was set apart. That word, again, it means to make a distinction. We find that word first in the scriptures in the book of Exodus. Recall the Israelites, they were slaves in Egypt. They were in bondage. And God says, Moses, I want you to go and I want you to set my people free. You're going to be a channel of my grace and my blessing to my people, even as they're in bondage and as I release them from bondage. And so the plagues, you know the story, began to fall. And at first, all the plagues fell upon all the people in Egypt, Egyptian and Israelite alike. But as the plagues continued, God said, "Now you're going to see my power." In Exodus chapter 8, verse 23, "I will make a distinction between my people and your people, Pharaoh. I'm not going to treat you all the same. I'm going to draw a distinction. I will set my people apart." And they began not to experience the effects of the plague. Exodus chapter 9, verse 4, "But the Lord will make a distinction between the livestock of Israel and that of Egypt." Not only does God make a distinction, he sets apart the people of Israel, he also sets apart the livestock of Israel. He says, I know so much, I am so powerful, I can cause a plague to fall on your cows and not on my people's cows. I can make that distinction. Exodus chapter 11, verse 7, "Then you will know that the Lord makes a distinction between Israel and Egypt." God was saying, "These people are mine." And it is God that David says, who takes the initiative. The force of the verb is that God causes the godly to be set apart for himself. He treats those who respond to him differently than those who reject him. The upside, according to David, of being set apart by God is that he knows that he has a special relationship with God. "The Lord will hear me when I call to him. I belong to God," David says. "I'm a child of God, and God will hear my voice and answer my prayer." Oh, we used to sing, "He knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls, and he hears me when I call." And that was David's confidence. David continues by giving counsel to his adversaries, those that God has not set apart, those who are not in the camp of the godly, but those who are in the camp of the ungodly. David begins to counsel and advise them because he wants them to come to understand things that they had not yet come to understand. Things that would allow them to experience God's peace and blessing as well. And as David speaks to them, we would do well to heed his counsel even as we wait for God's blessing, for his interaction, his intervention on our behalf. Those who have been set apart by God would be wise to do this as we wait on God. And that is simply this: don't allow anger or fear to derail your trust and obedience to God. David writes, "In your anger, do not sin." That word anger there, it means that agitation, quivering, quaking. In your quaking, in your quivering, do not sin. Now, I got to thinking, what is it that causes people to quiver and to quake? Well, at least two things. Anger. Have you ever seen someone so mad that they begin to shake? That they can't control themselves? They are just so angry. Have you ever seen someone so fearful? There's a term for it, isn't it? Knocking knees. So afraid. Begin to quiver. David says, in your quivering, when you are so angry, when you are so fearful, do not sin. Don't allow your anger or your fear to derail you from trusting in God. Even as you wait for God to act, continue to trust in Him and live in obedience to Him. This idea finds further emphasis in verse 5. David's counsel to us is offer right sacrifices and trust in the Lord. A literal translation of that would be offer sacrifices. Sacrifices of righteousness. Again, note the repetition. We saw that last week in Psalm 67. The same phrase repeated. When we see repetition in Scripture, it is for the sake of emphasis. And so David says, offer sacrifices, sacrifices of righteousness. Continue to do that which you know God has called you to do. Continue to do those things God wants you to do, even when, and especially when, He's not doing what you want Him to do. Have you ever found yourself in those circumstances? In frustration with God, we can so easily begin to cut moral and ethical and spiritual corners, either as a way of getting back at God for His seeming callousness towards us, or by thinking, I'll cut the corners. I'll work this out on my own. You see, that's what fear and anger does to us. When we become fearful, when we become angry at God, we begin to cut these corners and say, well, okay, when God comes through for me, then I'll come through for God. Last week, we were reminded that God's grace to us is not conditional. And neither should God's children's obedience and trust in Him be conditional. David calls us to continue to give God our best and to remain faithful to Him even as we wait for His intervention and blessing in our situations and in our lives, in our circumstances. Oh, David says, when you're waiting for God to act in your life, when you are awaiting His blessing, don't cut corners. Don't let your holiness slip. Don't let your faithfulness slide. But continue to do that which is right in the eyes of God. Offer right sacrifices and trust in the Lord. And this, when you are on your beds, search your hearts and be silent. He says, listen to the voice in your head. Listen for God's voice. Think about what it is that's causing you to quake and quiver in fear and anger. And in the quiet, think about what you are thinking about God as you wait upon Him. What are your thoughts about God as you lay awake at night in your bed? Are your thoughts about God's righteousness and mercy, or are your thoughts about God's failure and callousness and disinterest? As you lay awake in your bed at night, are your thoughts about God biblical and truthful? Or are they less than that? And think about as well what you're doing. As you wait, are you continuing to trust and obey? Or have you gravitated toward doubt and sin as you wait God's activity and blessing in your life? You see, when we find ourselves waiting on God, anxiously waiting on Him, May we do as David counsels us. May we remember that we have been set apart by God, that we are His children through faith in Christ, and He will always treat us as such with His love and wisdom and grace that only a Heavenly Father can do and has at His disposal. Remember who we are and commit ourselves to acting like who we are by trusting and obeying even while we are waiting. Oh, there's a song that we used to sing. I was once an outcast, stranger on earth, a sinner by choice and an alien by birth. But I've been adopted, my name's written down, an heir to a mansion, a robe, and a crown. Oh, we need to remember, as David did, I'm a child of the King. I receive His, He is the righteous God, the merciful God. I'm a child of the King, a child of the King with Jesus, my Savior. I'm a child of the King. And if you are a child of the King, and if you are a follower of Christ, if you are trusting in Christ and Him alone for your salvation, then you too are a child of the King. You are one of God's own. You are set apart by Him for His special attention and blessing. And even as we wait on Him, we can do so with complete assurance that the Lord will hear when I cry and call to Him. And with that knowledge, and with that confidence, David could lie down in peace at night and experience the peace of God, because he knew that he belonged to God. And so do all who are in Christ Jesus. Well, David concludes, many are asking, who can show us any good? It was a question being asked and raised out of despair and discouragement and hopelessness. How can we experience blessing when there seems to be so much bad stacked against us? And maybe you found yourself asking that very thing. David knew where to turn to experience good. And so he says, here's where we find good. We find it from God Himself. Oh God, he prayed, let the light of your face shine upon us, O Lord. God alone can, David knew, and would come to his aid. And David knew that God would once again pour out His blessing upon him, that He would show up and interact and intervene on his behalf. And in that confidence, David could say, you have filled my heart with greater joy than when the grain and the new wine abound, when the harvest has come in. Especially farmers, you know the joy when the harvest comes in. David says, you filled my heart with greater joy than when the grain and the new wine abound. And so each night, David could lie down and sleep in peace. For you alone, O Lord, make me dwell, made him dwell in security. What was David filled with joy? Did he lie down in peace at night because his circumstances had changed? That God had shown up? There's no evidence in Psalm chapter 4 that anything from verse 1 to verse 8 had changed at all. He was still in the same set of circumstances, the same narrowing. But David would rejoice, and he would live in joy and lay down in peace at night. And he would do so because of a heartfelt confidence that God would do right by him and his people. And he did so because he knew that God is merciful to his children and always hears their voice. And armed with that knowledge, that he was set apart by God, David would, and David could, lie down and sleep in peace. May that same confidence, may that same peace of God our Father rule our lives each and every day. Even on those days when we look for Him, and as we anxiously look to the horizon, waiting for Him to intervene and to act, and to bless our lives, well, may we still have that confidence and peace that He is the righteous God, that He's the merciful God, and we belong to Him, and He will do right by us. And may another songwriter's confidence give expression to all who belong to Christ. Even as our Heavenly Father asks us to wait upon Him for His blessing, for His intervention, may we be as the song says, may we be still, knowing with full confidence and assurance that the Lord Himself is on our side. He is merciful, and He is righteous, and He is with us.
To
Would you stand with me? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. And all God's people said, Amen.